I say this every week, I could have kept going all day on that. Hi guys, how you doing? My name is Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Welcome to this week's live stream where we'll be discussing the expressive vocabulary of possibly, probably the most influential guitarist of all time, Mr. James Marshall Hendrix. So intertwined is Jimmy with the world of guitar that his middle name was Marshall. Can you believe that? So anyway, listen, thank you very much for joining us. It is Monday evening. We're doing the thing that we do on Mondays, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. If you're enjoying these streams, do not forget, give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching on. It really does help. We really appreciate it. Drop us a comment. Let us know what your favorite Jimi Hendrix album is. I have mine, but we'll get to that. Mine is First Race, by the way, just throwing that out there. But, you know, we can talk about that. So whatever your favourite Jimi Hendrix album is or your favourite Jimi Hendrix performance, let us know. Let us know when you first heard Hendrix as well. Let us know what you thought when you first came across Hendrix. I came to Hendrix having already discovered kind of guys like Steve Vai and like Satriani and all these kind of shred types. And when I heard Jimmy for the first time, I was like, okay, this is not the same as that, but there's something special going on here. There's something special going on. So I'd love to hear about your first experience with Hendrix. We're going to be discussing Jimmy's expressive vocabulary. We'll just be discussing how you can sound more like Hendrix when you play those typical Hendrix licks that we, of course, will shout out as we go. But also, if you're having fun with these streams, if you're enjoying what we're doing, a couple of ways you can help us keep the lights on. You can help us by going to GI Plus, see this URL down here, you can go here and get a bunch of great guitar lessons, including but not limited to the Hendrix tech session that you guys that were here early would have heard as the trailer for this stream. Now, I'm going to play this for you all in just a moment, but you can get the full-length Hendrix tech session with note-for-note tuition of the tone, of the playing, of the thought process, the harmony, etc. You can get all of that as part of your GI Plus membership. So if you are thinking about signing up, maybe today is the day. And of course, we are here to celebrate Jimmy's, well, it was yesterday actually, but we're here to celebrate Jimmy's 80th birthday, if you can believe that. It's absolutely fascinating for me because I was talking to my partner about this, partner Nina, about this earlier on. I'm saying in our lifetimes, we're going to get to celebrate the 100th birthday of Jimi Hendrix, which is absolutely fascinating. But I absolutely adore me some Hendrix. And of course, we would be remiss not to discuss the enduring influence of Jimi Hendrix on other guitar players, because of course there are so many players out there who've drawn influence from Jimi. I'm willing to bet it's more players than you may have thought, right? More players than you may have thought in so many ways. So before we get into that in too much detail, I'm going to check in with the stream in a moment, but I want to hit you up and let you know that today's stream is brought to you by our friends at Hit & Mix, who make the software RipX. I'm going to say this wrong at least one point in today's stream, because there was a band in the Northeast that I used to kick around with, used to gig with on the same circuit as, and they were called RipX. So I'm going to get this mixed up because I've said this so many times over the years, but it is RipX. RipX is this great piece of software that lets you essentially unbake the audio cake. I'm going to show you this, by the way, in case you're interested. Today is the day to go and get your RipX subscriptions, because, or your RipX, to buy your RipX product if that's something you're interested in getting, and you should be interested because it lets you do this. Check this out. We're going to show as much of this as we can, but I found a live performance where Jimmy's just kind of going off on one. I want to show you the raw footage. This is 6 seconds, so it should be within copyright. Who knows? The Hendrix estate are famously litigious, but we might get away with this. Take a listen to this, and then I'm going to show you what we were able to do with RipX to extract Jimmy's guitar from the audio. Take a listen to this. Okay, did you catch it? What I did with this, I dropped that performance, that audio, directly into RipX, and I was able to get rid of the bass and drums, and I got it. And that was with precisely no tweaking, zero tweakery. So if you ever wanted to get into the nuts and bolts of what your favorite guitar players are doing, you want to isolate the guitar tracks in a fully baked recording, RipX is the place to get it. And we're taking a look at DeepCreate in an upcoming edition of Guitar Interactive magazine. That's a part of this software. We've reviewed a version of DeepRemix, which is the remix software, but it's still super useful for what we're doing. I'm just going to show you this very quickly, then we'll get into the stream. It's 1 minute, right? But check this
out. We've got guitar. Let's start by soloing that up. So if we hit this, you can see that a bunch of these notes, these blue notes and these little purple guys, have gone. Now, these refer to the percussion, which is in purple or pink, and the bass, which is in blue. If we solo up the guitar, all of our guitar stems are in this like kind of off-white, light blue kind of color. You can see we're left with just guitar notes over here. So let's play. Here, the bass is gone now, so have the drums. The drums aren't actually playing at this point, so let's fast forward a little bit further into where the drums would be playing. Now that is absolutely wild. If you wanted to take some drums out of a recording, let's say, you could drop it in like this. I've done nothing to this, by the way. I've literally just dragged it in, hit solo on the guitar, and it's got rid of the bass, it's got rid of the drums. That is something that a few years ago I would have told you was impossible, but apparently, hey, there you go, we've got it.
So that is a little brief look at our sponsor today, which is, of course, RipX by Hit & Mix. You can get that for 30% off on their Black Friday sale. It's extended to today, Cyber Monday. So if you're going to go and get it today. But do it after the stream, because we got a whole bunch of stuff to talk about. So we're going to get stuck into your comments. You guys have been dropping us some great comments so far. And then we're doing a little bit of teaching from our Jimi Hendrix tech session. It has been brought to my attention, by the way, that in that intro jam, there was no backing track. I could hear the backing track, but you guys couldn't hear the backing track. So fingers crossed. Who knows? I was having a good time. There was a backing track going on there. You have to imagine that it was in time. But even still. So let's crack on. We're going to turn our attention to the stream. Let's see who is in the house. PJ was first in the door at 5:45. PJ, you were here before I was. That's wild. I wasn't even setting up at that point. 5:45. That's crazy. Marcin is in the house at 6:14. I love that you guys get here so early and start chatting about stuff. That is killer. Marcin has his Strat. PJ has his PRS Custom 24. As Marcin has rightly predicted, the Silver Sky is in fact out tonight. You know what it is? True story. I had the EG4, which is my PRS with the two single coils and the humbucker. I had that lined up for this stream, and then I saw this comment and thought, you know what? I got to play the Silver Sky. We're not using tons of gain today either. We've got like the fuzz thing going on, so I figured the Silver Sky was probably a good shout. And yeah, it was good, man. Sacred Godslayer is in the house. We're going to try and convince Sacred Godslayer that Jimi Hendrix is great and that he actually likes Jimi Hendrix as we go on. It's kind of a metal thing. Metal guys, Jimi Hendrix. I get it. I understand. I get you. But he is suggesting that we listen to Shadow Gallery's record Tyranny while you wait for the beginning of the stream. Very cool. David Yates is in the house. Fellow Meathead. I don't even know if you are a fellow Meathead, but I always call him Dorian Yates because I'm a Meathead. I read things wrong. I read everybody's name wrong every time. So it says, hello guys. Hello, Nick. I'm a total Hendrix nut. He is the man. He is my man, hands down. Machine Gun, Fillmore East, the greatest guitar music ever made. Nick, you, sir, do an amazing Jimmy. That is super kind, because Jimmy is very, very hard to imitate. But we'll show you guys how to get it on the go today. Okay, Strat fan, says David Yates. Big headstock or small headstock, standard or reverse? Don't look at the headstock. Or are you a bit kinky and you like a Tele neck on a Strat like Jimmy had at Newport? No comment. I'm saying nothing. But yeah, let me know. Do you like the big headstock Strats? I'm a Malmsteen fan too, so I like the big headstock. I think it looks cool. But that small headstock, especially the Hendrix upside down, where the Strat upside down, that upside down vision of the headstock looked so cool. I do like reverse Strat headstocks, I've got to be honest. Connie Bloom had a really, really cool... really, really cool version of that too that I really liked. What else do we have? Strat tuned down a half step. I wouldn't tune it in a half step. We're going to do this in standard tuning today. But still, Dave's Confused, it's great to see you. Cowcat is in the house. Hank Staines is in the house. Hello all, looking forward to this one. I have a purple telly with a mirrored scratch plate and a Strat neck. That does not sound odd. That sounds cool. That sounds crazy cool. I love that. Larry Warren says, hello, the first time I heard Red House, I was so excited. Still a favorite. Me too, man. Me too. I think my first Hendrix exposure was Hey Joe. I want to say, which was a lot of people's first Hendrix exposure back in the day, because it was the first single, but it was certainly the first time I heard Hendrix, and whoa, special. I think I torrented it back in the day. Don't say that to the Hendrix estate, it'll come after me. Who else do we have? Let's keep on it. Far Cornish is in the house. Far Cornish dropped me a lovely message to say he's making some killer progress in his guitar playing thanks in some small part to what we're doing on these streams. Man, that's really kind of you to reach out and let me know. I appreciate that, man. Glad to see you on the stream. Great to see you. Jimmy, my friend Jimmy, with the I, J-I-M-I, is in the house. Jimmy is a good friend of mine from Preston in Lancashire. We have gigged together a whole bunch over the years. Jimmy's a great dude, great guitar player. Jimmy, it's lush to have you on the stream, man. Thanks for tuning in. Jimmy does a great Jimmy, as you might expect from his name. You would hope so. Riff Chord says, great tone and playing going on now. Hey, thanks, man. Appreciate that. Fab intro jam from Nick. Thank you so much. Very, very kind, you guys. D-Mac is in the house. Steve McDee's in the house. Blue Summon is here. Wouldn't be a stream without you. Who else? Keith MOF is in the house. Jeffrey's in the house. Kim, the big boss, is watching. Kim, it's great to see you. David Reese is in, Panu is in, Chris Brown is in, Live to Play Guitar is in, David Reese says, favourite Hendrix album, Band of Gypsies. Funnily enough, Jonathan Graham also agrees with you. Jonathan is in the comments, so if you guys want to talk to Guitar Interactive Editor, he also likes Band of Gypsies. Anyway, listen, Mark Crandall's in the house. Who else do we have? I'm just going to make a quick, some contention things too going on here. James Fair says, EJ plays Hendrix better. Contentious. Some people would say Stevie Jimmy Ray plays Hendrix better. I am not one of those people. For me, Hendrix, top of the tree. But anyway, so we've got loads of great comments. We will come back to your comments in a moment. My friend Steve Ferguson is in. Hey, Steve, how you doing? Zinni is in too. Of course. Fender Strat middle position. We'll talk about this. That is the thing. So anyway, listen, I want to show you guys a lick. So we've got something to work on. I'm going to show you the Hendrix tank session again. So the Hendrix tank session is, for these you guys who don't know, tank sessions are our term over at GI Plus for artist style files, let's say, where we take an in-depth look at the style of a particular artist. The Hendrix tank session was one of the biggest endeavors that I've ever taken on when it came to tech sessionary, because there's so much to talk about. But we're going to take a look at a lick, right? So let's go to this one. This is the first solo lick from my Hendrix tech session. You guys who were here early will have heard that already. That was our trailer for the stream today. So let's take a peek, and we're going to go to the close-up camera for this. So we have ourselves some tab. I'm going to guide you through this, and then we're going to talk a little bit about how we might play it. So the first part of this, we're going to be playing in C sharp minor pentatonic. So it's all box number one. We deliberately keep these streams inclusive, by the way, so we're not doing anything like super crazy technique wise. So everything here is pentatonic box one based around fret number nine. So you may think about it as fret nine, small shape, big shape. You do not need a Strat to play along with this, as evidenced by the fact that I don't have a Strat. Shush, no comment. I'm not saying anything. Anyway, so yeah, pentatonic box one. We are going to begin with a bend and a release from fret 12 up to the pitch of fret number 14. It's going to look and sound like this. Dead easy, right? One pick and then we bend and release. Let's get rid of the delay because that's a little bit annoying. We'll come back to our delay in just a moment. And then we have another bend from G, fret number 11, up to the pitch of fret number 13. We're not going to release this one. We're just going to bend it up, and then we're going to let it die and catch fret number 9 on our G string. So that's going to go something like this. Let me just play this for you real quick. So what we get is this. Here's our backing track. Let me know in the comments if you can hear the backing track this time. This is what I was playing along to in that whole intro, and nobody heard it, but it's fine. It's fine, I had fun, it's all good. So anyway, we're gonna play with our first bend. Let's try that together. I'm gonna go. You take a turn, here we go. I'm gonna go one more time, I'll go. That is a very characteristic Hendrix thing to do with this. But we'll come back to that, right? That's something we can talk about in just a moment. Are you guys getting the backing track? Let's see in the comments. I really, really hope you are. BT is okay, says everyone. Ooh, thank you very much. Oh, I gotta highlight this, by the way. It's all cool. Right, everyone be jealous of this man. Right, you've won the internet for the day. Everybody be jealous of this man. Saw Jimmy live in Flint, Michigan, 1968. So jealous, so jealous. I hope you've regained your hearing since then, because I gather it was probably pretty loud back in those days, but mate, I am very jealous of you. Congratulations, that is super freaking cool. So anyway, we've got a lick there. We're gonna do another lick, which is this second bar that you can see, which are more of these bends. Now that carries on to the ninth fret note, which is like right here at the end of, start of the next bar. Now the way to think about this is we're gonna do a bend from 11 on the G string. Remember we're in C sharp minor pentatonic. We're gonna bend it up and then very quickly release. Now here's an interesting point that Chris Brown has highlighted. One thing I always noticed about Jimmy is that on the grid timing is optional. For sure, right? This is the argument against gridded timing, because it's sometimes it's killer, sometimes it's not the thing. And for Jimmy, it is not the thing. So the way we're gonna get this anyway, this is our second lick. We're gonna play 11, we're gonna bend it up, then release that bend without re-picking it, but then we're gonna play by bending up to that note without a sweep up. It's like a pre-bend. We're gonna pick, we'll release, and then pick again, pre-bend, and pick, release, pick, pre-bend, release. And the very last one is gonna have a little sweep up, so we get this. Notice that difference. Notice it goes. Now, this is important. This is something we've talked about in bends before. We've talked about the idea of bends having a contour and having a shape to them. Now, one of the contour ideas that we talk about when it comes to bends, we talk about this in Expressive Techniques Part 1, by the way, which is one of our GI Plus courses that you can get by going to guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI Plus, link down below. If you want some more detail on this, that's something we talk about in this course. It's the contour of your bends. It's not just getting to the right note. It's how do you get there? And this is an example of some of the ways that Jimmy would contour his bends. So let's take a listen to that second lick along with our backing track, right? Let's take a peek. We're going to go like this. Here we go. If we go, notice there's no contour on the middle bends, only the first and last one. One more time, I'm going to go. So if we put that together with our first lick, let me throw my fuzz on. What we're going to get is this. We're going to get... That makes sense? Let's try it one more time together. I'm going to go... You take a pass. Ready? Here we go. You got it. Now, the last little portion of this lick, I'm going to teach you this one more time, because this lick's kind of important, and then we can discuss the expressive vocabulary a little deeper once we have the lick under our fingers. So the next part of the lick is going to be another bend, which is going to be on fret number 12. We're talking about this very last bar here, this bar right here. You guys see that? Right here. This is very difficult for me to do, but I'll do it because I like you guys, so there we go. We're going to bend from fret number 12 up to the pitch of fret number 14. Then we're going to release our bend and pull off to fret number 9. We're then going to play 9 again and then pre-bend and pick once again. So that last lick, again, a very Hendrix thing to do, which we'll talk about in a second. So our last lick is going to go like this. Time, I'll go. Your turn. Here we go. Okay, so the whole thing together is going to go like this. Shreddy lick optional at the end. Now, we try and keep these deliberately inclusive because we don't want everybody who isn't a fast-fingered monster out there to get lost off in these streams. We want you guys all to be able to get something out of it, especially the expressive stuff. So we're going to leave off the fast stuff. If you're wondering, by the way, a rough approximation of the fast lick that comes next is some kind of version of this lick. But with a hammer-on and pull-off to the 9. Coming back to this little motif towards the end. Now, for those of you who missed at the start, I'm going to take a moment and I'm going to show you the Jimi Hendrix tech session. When we come back, we're going to play this lick and we're going to talk a little bit more about the expressive vocabulary contained within. But check this out. You will hear this lick in the first solo of the Hendrix tech session. Here it is. You get this as part of your... Ooh, there we go. Branding's all gone. You get this as part of your GI Plus membership. It is this right here. Take a watch.
We'll be right back.
Now, let me tell you a little something about that, right? That tech session, ooh, that was a big undertaking. Because first of all, no pressure, it's Jimi Hendrix. Holy shit. But it was also a few haircuts ago, as you can tell. But we got a couple of questions about that, so I'll answer the questions first of all. Also, I want to know, by the way, what have you noticed about Jimmy's expressive techniques, like his bends, his slides, his vibrato, etc.? A couple of questions, though, and then we'll get back to our lick, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the bends, the vibrato, the expressive side of things, because that's what we're here to talk about. But Days Confused says, Nick, are you playing with nines? Your bends are so nice and smooth. I'm playing with tens today, but I did put some nines on that strap for the tech session. We used a kind of an authentic Hendrix gauge, which had like a nine. It was very light, very, very light. So one of the things that folks kind of miss about the Hendrix sound is, in addition to the strap thing, the strings are very light. Very, very light. And there's a very light touch going on as well. Very, very light touch, which enables you to be super, super groovy, enables you to do those lovely big singing bends to you. Now, I did have to get the action a little bit higher than I'd like, but it's fine. It's okay. No big deal. That was offset by the light strings, so it felt pretty comfy to play. However, oh man, we borrowed that strap from the lovely guys at DB24 over the road from the studio, and man, it was a nightmare keeping that strat in tune. It was just awful, but we got it in the end. But the fuzz was kind of important too. Fuzz were important too. We'll talk about the fuzz in a moment. But yeah, that middle pickup thing, here's a big deal, right? So we had a few things going on in there. New comments about the middle pickup. The middle pickup is a very, very underrated position for the Hendrix strat tone. So anyway, listen, right? Let's crack on with some more stuff. So we got some great comments coming in. Peter has really kind comments. Says, Nick, you have a great groove. Thanks, man. I really appreciate that. Jimi Hendrix had a fabulous groove. One of the best ever to do it. So you got to kind of get a little bit of that on the go. If you go, Mark Randall says, oh man, so great. Hey, Mark, that's really kind, man. If you want to learn it, you can get it as part of your GI Plus membership. Just go to Tech Sessions and you'll find it. There it is. The Hendrix bends from Fire, says Cowcat. If you nail those, you got it for sure. Those crackly unison bends. Oh man, so good, so freaking good. Okay, so let's get out of there, right? We're going to talk a little bit more about our licks. Let's get the tab back up on stream, and we're going to talk a bit about the Jimi expressiveness. Now, this is one of the big things that I feel like folks miss with Hendrix. Where's our tab? Let's go there now. Let's go to the close-up cam while we're on. So here's our tab. There's a close-up cam. So one of the things folks miss about Hendrix, I think at least, is the vibrato. So for me, I have tried very hard to find an earlier example of this, but I think Hendrix was the first guy to do the slow, wide rock vibrato. Let me play the lick with the backing track. I'm going to play it with kind of like a Peter Green style vibrato, let's say. So the Peter Green vibrato would be something like this. It's nice and slow, well, nice and fast even, quite even. Very, very fast indeed, very shimmery, almost like a BB King kind of thing. Hendrix was not that guy. Hendrix was this. It's really slow. It's almost John Sykes-esque in how slow it was, right? But check this out. Let's throw a bit of delay on, because delay is cool. So if I go, now let's do it again with the greeny vibrato. That is not it. It sounds cool, but it's not it. You guys have probably clocked this. That is not it. The Hendrix vibrato is very slow, very even, and very wide. Again, it is almost John Sykes-esque in that wideness. Now, we talked about John Sykes having this. It's not quite there, but it's not a million miles off. So let's try playing real quick. Let's do. And that vibrato you're going to do is a series of deliberate bend and releases. It's very sexy, very slow. It's a real sultry kind of thing. It's just like, it's so groovy and so cool. I love it, right? So let's play that first lick, and let's see if we can get some of that Hendrix vibrato on the go, and then we'll jam, right? So we're going to focus on our first lick. I'm gonna go real quick, like so. I'll go. Mm-hmm. notice how that was not on the grid? Chris Brown hit that on the head, hit the nail on the head. The timing is very loose, we'll get to that in a minute. So one more time, let's play that first lick and then you're gonna take a solo. We're in C sharp minor, you can take C sharp minor pentatonic. We'll start with the lick, we're gonna play it together and then you're gonna go off in one and give me some of that Jimmy vibrato. So I'm gonna go like this. Your turn. See if you can catch some of that Jimmy vibrato when you're playing. It's really slow. That's what we want. It can be a little bit longer. And then I'm going to take a pass, right? So I'll go like this. Here we go. Turn, here's the lick, your solo, and here we go. Give me some of that Jimmy vibrato. That's what we want. You know what you're looking for. It's slow, it's wide. I want to hear you. Real nice. It's very, very difficult to get right, but once you nail it, it is so cool, right? So that is the Hendrix approach to vibrato. Chris Brown had another real great point with this where he talks about the application of the vibrato. Application, lovely licks, says Mustafa. Hey, thanks, man. I appreciate that. Really appreciate that. So anyway, a real great observation from Chris Brown. I hope I starred this because, here it is. Another thing I've noticed from Jimmy is that he introduces his vibrato very early on his bends. That's something we've talked about again in our course, which is Expressive Techniques Part 1. I'll tell you more about that in a moment. I'll tell you more about that as time goes on. So this is what we refer to as vibrato onset. So it's how quickly do you get to the vibrato? If you're doing Malmsteen, for example, right? Malmsteen in a Hendrix tech session, what? But even still, if you're doing Malmsteen, you tend to find the vibrato, while it is similarly wide, you hear a lot of Hendrix in Malmsteen's vibrato, oddly. He's a Hendrix fan. He said as much, among other things, but you hear a lot of that Hendrix touch in Malmsteen's vibrato. It's a little more melodramatic from our Swedish shred friend, but it also takes a little bit more time to get going. So in Malmsteen, you'll hear this. Instantly, if you guys want us to do a Malmsteen one of these, then we will. But that's not the subject of today. So a little more time to get going on the Malmsteen thing. For Jimmy, it's almost instant. You guys can hear that? Love it, absolutely love it. So that's the Hendrix vibrato. Let's talk a little more about timing. So timing is an important thing with this. It's a very, very important part of every guitar player's sound, but specifically the Hendrix sound. The timing aspect that I want to talk about here is not just how loose Jimmy's playing is, but his use of staccato. So you'll find that although Jimmy's improvisations, because he generally played as part of a three-piece, although his improvisations don't have a lot of space in them in terms of like empty silence that you might find from someone like Peter Green, for example, what we do get is we do get these lovely silences in between notes and in between phrases that are filled with either noise, which is very cool, the noise we'll talk about in a second, or just let hang. So what you might find on this sort of phrase, if we take the way that I might instinctively play this phrase, if I did it without the Jimmy silences, I might play this. It's not really very Hendrix, but if we start to punctuate those notes with a little bit of silence, like this first bit, that lick with a silence, that is such a Hendrix thing to do. And the same thing with here. Not afraid to play that note over and over again, but those silences really make the difference. Sounds like super, super Jimmy when we do that. Now, there are some tricks that we can talk about. We'll get into some tricks if you guys want some Hendrix tricks. We can do that too, because tricks are cool. Incidentally, by the way, just realized my headstock is pointing at this. Just want to remind you that today's stream is brought to you by our friends at Hit & Mix that enabled us, just show you this one more time, to take this Hendrix recording. and extract the guitars from the Now, what you'll get from hearing that recording, that's a live recording, by the way. That's absolutely unbelievable because it's a grainy old live recording and we were able to suck the guitar out and study it, which is very cool indeed. So one thing you'll notice from that live recording in particular, is the Hendrix timing. So this is really, really freaking cool, right? This is really, really freaking cool because what you find with Jimi is there's almost a conversational flow to both his singing and also to his playing, right? So his playing has a very similar kind of sense of, I guess, kind of like laid back conversational timing. Now, this is very different to the way you might play if you were playing, let's say, fusion, or if you were playing real tight funk stuff, let's say. But maybe what we need is, well, let's take an approach to this, right? Let's take a lick. Let's take maybe that first, well, the lick that we have here, this. What you'll find with this is the Hendrix way of doing this sort of stuff is to basically play the lick that you were going to play in your own time. So it's like, it's almost like, I'm in no rush, I'm going to play this regardless of how long it takes. I'm not going to rush it, I'm just going to take my time. Whether it lines up with the grid, we'll get there in the end. So an example of this, let me show you what we're talking about, right? So here's a backing track, let's just hide the tab for a moment. I'll show you what I'm talking about, right? Let's just get rid of the tab so you guys can see what I'm playing. So, very quickly, if I was to play very on the grid, we have this kind of 6/8 full score on here, which is this, a 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3. That's how you count 6/8, by the way. 8 implies compound time, so you don't count all 6. You count just 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3. That's another story for another day. We'll get to that. Time signatures, who knew? If I play very on the grid, I might get something like this. Clapton when you play on the grid like that. But if we take our time with the licks, so we just let them fall where they may, we're gonna play our lick, we're in no hurry, you guys in the rhythm section, keep doing what you're doing, we'll get there when we get there. We get more of this sort of thing. It's almost like the timing kind of encapsulates how Jimi was, I don't know about as a person, I would assume as a person, but certainly his persona of being like cooler than cool, like, listen, man, we're going to get there when we get there. And I absolutely adore that. That is really, really freaking cool. So that timing, oh, so good. So, so good. Anyway, listen, right? We got some crises going on in the stuff. Here's another thing, right? There's a fantastic separation of the lick. Is that a program? Yeah, Peter, that is our sponsor today, right? That is Hit and Mix RipX. You can get that at the link down below. It's on sale, 30% off, right? Go get it, because you can drop any audio into it and pull the guitar out and just listen to the guitar. Amazing. Or you can just silence the guitar and have just the bass and drums so you can play along. Super freaking cool. So let's see some tricks anyway, right? So we've talked about Hendrix's timing, we've talked about his bends. We haven't really talked about the bends, actually. Let's touch on the bends. So with Hendrix, what you tend to find with the bend thing is you tend to find the bends are either one of two, I guess kind of one of two things. You either have these very quick transition bends that are either a little whoop, or they're just a direct pre-bend, or you get the longest bend in the entire world. Now, the longest bend in the world, this is something Guthrie Govan pointed out, and when I heard it, I was like, that is such a Hendrix thing to do. Where if we're trying to bend, say, this 12th fret, what you might do is instead of bending this, you might find that Jimi would do something like this. There. But we slide into this huge bend, and it sounds like the bend has come all the way from here. It's almost like a one octave bend, if you can imagine such a thing. Now, we said Jimi used light strings, but they weren't that light. But what we get is this. Mm-hmm. very, very cool. Now, those big, huge bends you hear an awful lot in Jimmy's playing, but you also hear these big, languid, descending phrases. Very big, languid bends that aren't really so much... I'm not going to say they're not musical, because they are musical, but they aren't so much musical pitches as they are sort of like dramatic sounds. They sound like a voice. They sound like somebody in, you know, like experiencing sorrow or pleasure or heartache or whatever. It's very, very cool, right? Very, very cool. Now, some tricks. Let's talk about tricks. First of all, the obvious trick, right? I'm going to show you a few of these. So you will have heard me do this... this Hendrix fake wah trick. I just want to show you how that works. You need a guitar with pickups with different tone controls on them. I like this anyway, because it's a cool way to get a slide tone, right? But if you dump the tone control on your neck pickup, right? Dump the tone control on the neck pickup, keep the bridge pickup wide open, start doing some trills or some bends, and flick your pickup selector from the tone control off, neck pickup, to the tone control wide open bridge pickup, you can get this sort of thing. Which you would have heard in the intro to Voodoo Child, for example. This great. That's that, and it's super freaking cool. But I want to talk to you a little more about the neck pickup thing. So if you have a fuzz, we talked about this before, right? If you have a fuzz, first of all, if you have a cool fuzz, right, you can roll your volume control down maybe on the middle pickup selection and get this really great. Great sort of like almost clean tone. But if we go to an octave fuzz, let's say, now this isn't going to work with a modern like pog type octave fuzz, but an Octavia type fuzz like the one I'm playing right now, our neck pickup becomes really super interactive with the fuzz. So you hear that extra octave kind of coming in there. This is one of the Jimmy things, right? Jimmy was one of the first guys, to my mind at least, to really embrace the march of technology when it comes to the guitar. So not only did he take a look at the three pickups and three controls that we have on this sort of fiddle and went, I could do something with that, but he was also the first guy with like tons and tons of pedals on the floor that I was aware of, certainly anyway. I'm sure there were people before, but Jimmy's the dude who popularized it. And the octave fuzz, this modified fuzz by Roger Mayer, this Octavio, which became the Octavia, has this really interesting property where if you're playing on a very bright sound on your guitar, you don't get so much octave. So what I can do, let me show you this. I'll go to the close-up cam real quick. So if I have my octave fuzz and I'm on the bridge pickup, don't get that much octave. I just get this kind of rattly fuzz thing. But what I might do, if I go to my neck pickup, you'll hear more of the octave come in. But then as I start to turn my tone control down on the neck pickup, you'll hear this octave become really super prominent, right? Check this out. Let's roll it down. So with your octave fuzz, what you kind of get is you get this, dare I say, almost this ability to dial in the amount of octave that you want using the guitar's pickups and the guitar's tone controls, volume controls. It's a very cool trick. And that is, again, something that you'll see with the Hendrix thing, I guess. And of course, you know, David Yates is using all of it, right? He's using a bit of reverb, octave fuzz, univibe, plexi, tape echo, a bit of reverb. Man, I'm going to take you through my little chain here, right, real quick. So what I've got is I have two fuzz pedals on the ground, but I have a univibe as well, and I have the tape style echo. So, okay. This is the Super Kraken on gain one. Right, that's it, right? Here's my fuzz face type fuzz. It's actually a Boss, it's one of the Wazza fuzzes. It's not the Tone Bender, but it's cool, man. I think it sounds great. And then I've got my octave fuzz here. And then the controversially univibe, Strymon Mobius. Tape delay. Sort of the middle position. Freaking cool, right? So that's the chain. Liv Blake's art says, do you go over this in the Hendrix course in excruciating detail, right? So much of this stuff goes on the so much of the stuff is in the tank session, right? So if you guys want more on this, right, we've gone like into like some pretty deep detail on the expressive stuff here, but Hendrix's playing is so deep, right? If you want to get into the licks, the thought process, the rhythm thing that everyone does, everybody immediately reaches for that kind of like little wing angel, Wind Cries Mary type, like chord lead thing. That stuff is really super cool, right? That is all included in the Hendrix course, right? So the Hendrix tech session is absolutely massive, right? You guys have heard it before. It's our biggest tech session to date. We did it, it's a while ago now, but man, I'm super proud of it. You get it as part of your GI Plus membership. If you want some more Hendrix, that's the place to go. In the meantime, we're going to be answering your questions, right? So if you have questions, drop your questions down in the comments below, right down here. Drop your questions. When we come back, we'll be talking more about whatever it is that you guys want to talk about. It doesn't have to be Hendrix related, but if it is Hendrix related, even better. So if you've got questions, I have answers for you. But in the meantime, let me take a moment to show you this. This is the latest full-length course that you get as part of your GI Plus membership. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. It's something ludicrous, like 5 hours in length, and it covers everything to do with vibrato, bends, and slides. If you didn't think that you can get 5 hours of learning out of those three techniques, man, you are in for some fun when you click on this stuff, right? Because we go so deep. And if you ever wanted to know what it is that makes great players tick with this sort of stuff, this is how you're going to figure it out. So Expressive Techniques Part 1. When we come back, we'll talk about your questions.
Hi guys, Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Does your playing sound like this? When really you'd like it to sound like this. Now, the difference between these two examples are not the notes that are being played, but rather the way the notes are being played. I'm sure you've heard this before. Guitar players will say to you, it's not what you play, it's how you play it. And when it comes to creating interesting, emotive, and musical sounding guitar lines, that is very much the case. And in this course, Expressive Techniques Part 1, we aim to equip you with the tools to sound more musical, more emotive, more interesting, and ultimately more expressive on the guitar. And we are going to do this by exploring the three principal left-hand expressive techniques, which are slides, bends, and vibrato. I'm going to show you the mechanics of these techniques and how you can execute them cleanly, efficiently, and reliably. I'll also give you some exercises to help develop these techniques, and we're also going to discuss some musical applications, how you might use these techniques in your own playing. We're going to go into great depth with that stuff, and I'm also going to give you a solo study, a piece of music I've prepared, and I'm going to encourage you and kind of guide you through the process of applying expression to an otherwise expressionless and bare sounding piece of guitar playing. So at the end of this course, you are going to be able to take otherwise uninteresting and fairly dry pieces of music and turn them into expressive, colorful, musical lines. And you're also going to be able to take this and apply it to your own playing or to other people's music that maybe you're playing and you want to express in your own way. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive GI Plus. I hope you'll join me. I will see you in there. So there you go, guys. That is a look at Expressive Techniques Part 1. You get that as part of your GI Plus membership. It's a huge, super deep course, dovetails with all the stuff we've been talking about in these streams, specifically the expressive stuff, because, man, it just like... Yeah, I feel like it just feeds into itself in a really, really nice way. So we've got some great questions already. Going to touch on these as we go. So Roberto Alves has a really good point. There's, I have a vintage where the bridge pickup is tilted backwards, so it sounds like the upside down Hendrix guitar pickup position for us non-left-handed players. What he's referring to is, I'll show you in the close-up cam real quick, this pickup is the other way around, and that is a big part of the Hendrix sound. Big part of the Hendrix sound, certainly the bridge pickup sound. It's one of the reasons why Jimmy's bridge pickup was a little bit sweeter on the treble strings than maybe mine is, because, I mean, these pickups are super fat and sweet anyway, but if you ever wondered why Hendrix's bridge pickup tone was, like, really biting on the low notes, but really quite sweet in the high notes, it's because his bridge pickup is the other way around. Really interesting point. Chris Brown says, stereo panning. You would have noticed, man, if you're listening in headphones, you would have noticed I had to put some stereo panning in the tech session when I mixed it. Like, absolutely had to do it. I'm like, yep, we're putting some stereo panning in there for sure. Seagull Rock Squawk says he wants to learn some tricks. I may do some more tricks in a minute. Tricks are cool. David Yates has a really interesting question. Question for later. Can you please interview Uli Roth and persuade him to show you Hendrix's favorite Strat, which Jimmy called Black Beauty? He has it in a bank vault. P.S. Plus, I love you, Uli. I love Uli too, right? Uli's a great guitar player. If you've ever wondered what the intersection of like Hendrix and Malmsteen would be, if like you didn't go all the way Malmsteen, you'd probably get Uli. Uli's fabulous instrumentalist, like just wicked technique, but loads of Hendrix in his playing too, which I love. I think he's killer. If we can interview him in his bank, then maybe we'll see it. But you know what? Like, hey, listen, Jonathan is the man who arranges all this stuff. Jonathan, if you're watching, I will interview Uli in his bank and I will ask that question. Who knows? Anyway, so what else do we have? Rick Elliott has a really interesting point, but a very kind comment as well. He says, the synapse between the brain and the hand technique you demonstrate is truly remarkable. Thank you so much, man. That's very kind of you. Interestingly enough, that synapse thing is it's quite fascinating, because that is basically what we do when we learn. We are developing new neural pathways, and I've spent a lot of time trying to optimize is a bad word, because optimize has some connotations, especially in the fitness industry in 2022, which are, you know, maybe pseudoscientific at times, but I have spent a lot of time trying to develop very strong motor pathways. And I've done lots of exercise that are dedicated towards that. Maybe we'll talk about that one day. Who knows? Maybe, but thanks, man. I appreciate that. Helmet Strap says, it's a great name. Helmet Strap says, can RipX separate guitar tracks in a song? I thank you. I thank you too. Yeah, it can. So if you have an AC/DC tune, you can separate Angus from Malcolm and solo them. Very cool. Might take a little bit of tweaking, but it's pretty good even when you just drop it in. But you can do loads of tweakery too if that's something you want to do. Peter Jaffelice. No, Jaffelice. I read people's names wrong. Jaffelice.
Very great name, great name. I've read everybody's name wrong, Peter. It's not your fault, it's my fault. Peter, I should just say Peter, who's playing his guitar with a bow in his thumbnail, which is super freaking cool. There's only like two or three guitar players I know who can get away with that. So hey, well done you, that's killer. It says, are there tabs for the text sessions and all of GI lessons? Yes, there are tabs. And there are also note-for-note tuition. So you get both. You don't just get the whole thing where it's like, I'm not going to name any names, but these education sites where you get, here's the performance, here's me ripping, here's a PDF of the tab, smack on the bum, good luck. You don't just get that. You get tab, but you also get face-to-face tuition. So you get the whole banana. And not only do we teach you the note-for-note, but we also talk about why. So it's not just, here are the notes, it's here, why are these the notes? So yeah, you get all that stuff too. So yeah, GI Plus, down below. Dennis Confused says, how do you control all that energy slash noise when playing in those maxed out Hendrix modes? Dude, hey, thanks, man. Sometimes you gotta embrace it. I'll say that right away. Sometimes you don't need to control the noise. Sometimes you just want to go, especially if you've got all the noise on. But what you'll notice, I'm quite quick on my volume control. I'm quite quick at turning that down in between things. But a lot of times with this sort of sound, because the attack is so blurred by the fuzz, you can kind of just hit the thing and then reveal the note once you've hit it by muting. Let me show you what I'm talking about. So if I talk about this, that right there, I'm just battering all of those strings. There's a lot of noise, but what I'm doing is, once I've hit all of those strings, I'm dampening down the ones that I don't want to sound after the fact, which kind of allows the note to come through, if that makes sense. So it's almost like we kind of just make a load of noise and then dampen down everything that's not the note. Takes a bit of practice, takes some well-refined instincts on the instrument, but, you know, with a bit of practice, I don't see any reason why anybody couldn't get there. That's kind of all it is. Nobody wakes up, you know, nobody's born with this capacity, apart from maybe Jimmy. I don't see why you couldn't get there, for sure. So anyway, let's go to some more questions. We have some real good ones. So we have, sounds like an Yngwie lesson. Is that the one where you get, referring to the comment of like, here's the PDF of the tab, and the tab is wrong. The tab is wrong on all the Yngwie lessons. The tab is not wrong on GI Plus. I made sure of it. I did most of the tabs, so tab is right. But yeah, it's like the Yngwie lessons are famous for being like, oh, here's the tab. I can't do Yngwie's accent. I can almost do Arnold's. But you end up with stuff where, like, clearly he's doing this. I can't do that. But, like, the transcriber's going, it's like, that's not it. You can see that's not it. What are you doing that for? Anyway, we've got some more questions. Nick, do you like Vinnie Moore? I love Vinnie Moore. Absolutely love Vinnie Moore. Riff Chord is putting me on the spot. Why do you do this to me, man? Like, I love these questions. I'm joking, right? I'm only kidding. I love it. It says, do you feel Trower or SRV does Hendrix better? Okay. I feel like Trower does the Hendrix thing more authentically, but I prefer listening to SRV do Hendrix. How's that for a diplomatic answer, I guess? And also, even though it's not super authentic, I would say absolutely love watching Steve Vai do Hendrix. Shh, don't say that. Anyway, blasphemy. Anyway, would you say Hendrix's playing music was too far ahead of its time? I don't know about too far ahead of its time, but it was definitely way ahead of what was going on musically and compositionally in the guitar world at that period. I don't think it was something where, like, we only got it after the fact. Although there were a lot of bands that were like that, like Led Zeppelin. People kind of forget that Led Zeppelin weren't this, like, world-straddling band, you know, up there in the pantheon on their first and second albums. They were huge, sure, but people didn't really give them the credit they were due. It was almost like these famous painters, right? It was like a Van Gogh thing, although I don't think Jimmy Page is about to die in poverty, that's for sure. Here's a fun thing, by the way, talking about Hendrix, by the way. Do you guys know that Hendrix for all we associate Hendrix's career is basically kind of kicking off in London. Kicking off in America, and then he comes to London, huge boom. Hendrix spent a good period of time in Newcastle. He's managed by Chas Chandler from the Animals, who are a band from Newcastle. Spent a lot of time playing in Newcastle. He used to busk on Chillingham Road in Heaton, which is pretty wild. So Hendrix's first, I guess he's an honorary Geordie. Let's say that's what I'm trying to say. Right, we're taking ownership of Hendrix. Right, we have Knopfler, we have Hendrix, we have Sting. It's pretty good. It's not bad. Anyway, that's my little claim that Hendrix is a. Oh, here's a really good one. Very quickly. Greg Koch does a great Hendrix impression for sure. Slade's manager says Peter for sure, absolutely right. Charles Chandler managed a bunch of folks, and you know had some success himself. Let's just say I do love me the Animals. Amazing, says Peter. They're very happy about the tabs. I'm definitely joining. Superb, man. Thank you so much. I'm glad that you're joining, right? You'll get some use out of it. Now, listen, for you guys who are GI Plus members or you are just kind of like thinking about it, don't forget, you can reach out to me anytime you like on Instagram. You can reach out on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. Send me a message on whatever platform you want. My Instagram is at Nick Jennison, and we can talk. So if you're interested in, you're interested in GI Plus, but you're not sure where to start, maybe you've signed up for your membership and you go, oh my God, there's so much stuff in here. I didn't realize how much stuff there was. There is a ton of stuff. I can help you. So I can help you find material that will be right for you. So yeah, don't be afraid to reach out and talk, right? Or just let me know how you're getting on, right? I'd love to hear from you guys. Tag me in your playing. Chris Brown does it all the time and I never get sick of it. So you guys who are uploading playing, tag me. I want to see it, right? I want to see you playing. So if you're uploading playing to Instagram, to Facebook, to wherever, tag me in the thing. Guys, in the meantime, I'm gonna have to bid you adieu. Once again, thank you so much for joining us. This stream was brought to you in collaboration with Hit and Mix, who allowed us, I'm gonna show you one more time because it's such a cool trick, right? They allowed us to take this Hendrix and turn it into this Hendrix button. This sponsored tonight's stream. It's been great fun. I'm going to play you out because I didn't get a chance to actually jam over the backing track for real. My name's Nick Jennison. Next week, I'm going to tell you about who we're doing next week just because, right? I'm going to let you in on the secret. Next week, we are discussing, don't tell anyone, Brian May. Oh, exciting times. But in the meantime, my name's Nick Jennison. I'll see you guys next week. Here is some more of my impression of Jimmy. Not this Jimmy, but this is a good Jimmy too. In the meantime, see you next week. Still will, but I'll see you guys next week. In the meantime, this is GI Plus. See you next week. My name is Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from Fusion Maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.